there's honey in the rock.
Please join with me in the call to worship. We come to prepare for the holiest of weeks. Jesus leads us through this week, and we will follow, for he is the life we long for. He is the word who sustains us. Setting aside all power, glory, and might, he comes modeling humility and obedience for all of us. Please stand if you are able and join with us in the opening hymn, Hosanna Loud Hosanna, page 278 in your hymnal or on the screens. Riding down the streets of Jerusalem on a donkey, we expect. Your power doesn't look like the power we want our God to demonstrate. Your wisdom makes no sense to us. We are happy to join the crowd, waving branches, but not so sure we want to follow you into the temple courts, into the upper room, into the Garden of Gethsemane, to the foot of the cross. Forgive our false assumptions. Clarify our clouded vision. Let us relax into the foolishness of your love, your grace. Hosanna, Hosanna, save us, we beseech you. Amen. You may be seated, and our ushers can come forward for the presentation of tithes and offerings. As we bring our gifts and lay them at your altar, we remember the crowds in Jerusalem who laid their cloaks on the road, shouting, "Hosanna," as Jesus passed. We know that they were military might, but one who came in compassion and mercy to heal, love, and save. Search out our hearts that we might be confident that the Messiah for whom we long is the one you know we need, Jesus Christ, your anointed one, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Just a reminder as this week progresses that some of the services will be here and some of the services will be at Lakeview. I wanted to encourage you to be a part of this week, whether it's in this church or in Lakeview. Just join together as a church as we celebrate and go through this week. The scripture for this morning comes out of the book of Mark in the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 11. And it reads, "When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, 'Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Just say this, the Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.' They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them, what Jesus has said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on him and sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the field. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The word of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you and welcome you into this house. Lord, open our hearts, open our minds. Father, I ask that you put me to the side and bring the cross to the forefront. Lord, help us this day to begin this week of terror, this week of hope lost, but also a week of promises made and hope reborn. It is through Christ we pray. Amen. It's been estimated that more than 2,500,000 people crowded their way into Jerusalem during the Passover. And we're told that Jesus entered this bustling city on a colt that no one had ever ridden. And as he did so, many of the people spread their cloaks on the road, sort of like rolling out the red carpet, while others spread branches on the road. And all the folks, the ones who ran ahead of Jesus and the people who followed Jesus, shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming king of our father David. Hosanna in the highest." What were they asking for? What did all this mean? What did the crowd want? And what did they expect? We can get an idea by looking at the word Hosanna. This is a word that we often misunderstand. To our ears, it may sound like praise or a blessing. In actuality, the word Hosanna is a plea. It means save now. And the blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Well, the one who comes is another name for the Messiah. And Hosanna in the highest means let the angels in the highest heights of heaven cry to God, save now. So as Jesus rode into a busy Jerusalem at Passover time, on a colt that had never been ridden before, those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Save us now! Blessed is the Messiah! Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David! Save us now!" They were pleading with Jesus for salvation. Save us now. They were calling him the Messiah. But what kind of salvation did they want, and what kind of Messiah did they think Jesus was? The Jews had been under Roman occupation for quite some time. They were oppressed by the Romans. They had to pay taxes to the Romans. They wanted to be freed from the Roman rule. And they expected that the Messiah was going to save them from Rome. So save us now means save us now from Roman military occupation. We want to be great and strong again. We want to rule like we did when David was king. In essence, the people wanted another King David. And they thought that Jesus was the one who was going to fill that role. They believed that he would stand up to Rome. They believed Jesus would overthrow the Roman military. They believed Jesus would make Israel a great ruling nation once again. They believed that Jesus would conquer all their foes. The people were looking for a king, a Messiah, a Jesus who would shatter, smash, kill, break, and conquer. They were looking for Jesus to bring in the kingdom of God by military force. Save us now, they cried. Save us now, blessed Messiah. And certainly salvation for the people was exactly what Jesus had in mind. But it was salvation on God's terms and not on the people's terms. Jesus' salvation contradicted everything that the people had hoped for and expected. Imagine how wrong they must have felt when just a few days later they saw him arrested and saw him on trial. Imagine what went through their head. Imagine thoughts. Thoughts such as, well, this is some king. Thoughts, oh, yeah. Yeah, look at this Savior. Boy, this is some Messiah, isn't it? And then a lot of them would say, crucify him. As Jesus hung from the cross, a bloody mess of a man, the written notice that hung above his head read, the King of the Jews. And those who passed hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, come down from the cross and save yourself. We're told that in the Gospel of Mark that in the same way the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves, he saved others, but he can't save himself. Let this King of Israel come down now from the cross that we may see and believe. Certainly Jesus could have come down from that cross, but that's not why he came. Certainly if he wanted to, Jesus could have been the conquering Messiah, but that was not his mission. Certainly Jesus could have saved the people in those terms, but that's not God's plan. The people wanted Jesus to save them, but they wanted Jesus to save them in the way that they thought they ought to be saved. They simply do not understand what Jesus and God had in mind. The question for us is this. What are we looking for in this Jesus? What does it mean to be saved by Jesus? Does it mean that we become conquering heroes? Does it mean that we become the next American Idol on TV? Does it mean that we become powerful in the worldly sense? Does it mean that we become rich? Does it mean that life no longer is difficult? Does it mean any of that? When Jesus rode into Jerusalem, it was obviously impossible for him to speak to the crowd. So instead, he did something that all could see. He came riding upon a donkey's colt. And this was a deliberate claim by Jesus that he was indeed the Messiah. It was dramatic. It was a dramatic reenactment of the words of Zechariah. The prophet from Zechariah 9 reads, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He will proclaim peace to the nations. And nobody was looking for that. There's no doubt that Jesus claimed was a messianic claim, but Jesus was claiming to be a certain kind of Messiah. In Jesus' day, a king came riding on a horse when he was getting ready for war and conquest, and he came riding on a donkey. He came in peace. So Jesus was telling the crowds what kind of Messiah he was to be by the fact that he was riding on the colt of a donkey. He was not the warrior figure that the people dreamed, but instead he was the Prince of Peace. No one saw it that way at the time, not even his disciples. No one understood what Jesus meant. The question is, do we understand this day? If Jesus saves, then why can't he save himself? Jesus did not save himself because Jesus did not need to be saved. We did, and we still do in this world today. Jesus did not come down off that cross because Jesus came to save us and not himself. Jesus did not come to conquer and rule by force. And he certainly didn't come to set up some kind of messianic kingdom right here, right now on this earth. At least not in the material sense. Jesus' kingdom is spiritual. And those who know Jesus, those who are saved by Jesus, those who worship Jesus, worship him in spirit and in truth. Jesus' kingdom is a spiritual kingdom. Jesus' salvation is a spiritual salvation. Jesus comes and conquers the hearts of people. And he only does this in a peaceful and loving manner. When people who believe in him want to be saved through free will, invite him to come into their hearts and their minds and in their lives as Savior and Lord. I wonder, have we invited Jesus to come into our hearts and to our minds and our lives as our Savior and Lord? When we ask Jesus to come into our hearts as Savior and Lord, something miraculous happens to us. You see, we begin to change. We begin to change on the inside. We begin to see things the way God sees things, and we begin to value what God values. Service, love, patience, and so, so much more. And as Jesus becomes our Savior, we find that we are not necessarily saved from many of the heartaches that come in this world. If we're in a certain situation financially or physically or whatever, these kinds of situations are probably not going to change. What will change will be our ability to cope with all the difficulties of life. Jesus has come to bring us peace. But this does not mean that we will not be surrounded by wars and rumors of wars and so forth. What this does mean is that we will be able to face whatever comes our way with a peace that transcends all understanding. Jesus saves. And Jesus is the only one who does save. But Jesus saves in a way that Jesus, not in a way that we might save. Therefore, just as Jesus came riding into Jerusalem, humble on a donkey, we are to humble ourselves before God and before one another. And just as Jesus rode into Jerusalem, as the one who came to bring peace, we all must desire peace, not conquest, not competition, not power, but peace. Because salvation on God's terms has absolutely nothing to do with military victory, financial gain, selfish desires, or worldly fame. Salvation on God's terms is being saved from all that stuff to get all together. Salvation on God's terms is the exact opposite of what our natural selves desire. Whoever wants to save his life or lose will lose it, and whoever loses it will find it, Jesus says in Mark 16. Salvation on God's term means giving God our very lives. It means giving God our very natures, giving God our very own selfish desires. It means handling ourselves completely over to God and trusting God to take control and trusting God to change us, to guide us, to direct us, to use us so that we can love God and others and be freed from the chains of selfish desires. And when that happens, we really begin to live then. We begin living for the very first time. If you have not done so already, are you willing to cry out to Jesus on this Palm Sunday and simply say, Hosanna, Jesus, save me now? This week is my favorite time of year. This is the week where my emotions will go up and down and all around. It's a time that sleep becomes difficult. It is a time that I'll spend even a little more time in Scripture, a little more time in prayer. And the reason that I do that is because, not to be selfish, but the only reason Jesus Christ came into this world was for me. You can go ahead and think that for yourself, but I know it for myself. I knew who I was before I ran into Jesus, and I know who I am since I had this journey. You see, this week is really important. It's important for us to remember of what Jesus is trying to teach us and tell us all. But most important is that Jesus is telling us not so much about us, but who He is. Whatever is in your world, whatever situation is in your world, you and Jesus can take care of it together. When the world falls apart, Jesus is still Lord and Savior. When everything gets turned upside down and topsy-turvy and everything, if we'll just come to Jesus, there is peace. There is peace in that presence of Jesus. But sometimes, somehow, we forget all that stuff. We forget our relationship. It's like forgetting a relationship with our own family sometimes. That may sound kind of weird for some of us, but it does happen in the world. But I tell you this, before you and I were born, God had a plan for us. And that was through His Son, Jesus Christ. And through Jesus Christ, there is always a tomorrow. There is always a tomorrow in Jesus Christ. And in Christ's words, when it comes time for us to leave this world, the words of Jesus Christ says, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come and receive you unto myself. See, we're never left alone. We're always in the presence of Jesus. We're never out of His reach. We're never out of His earshot. We're never out of a place to go when the world falls apart. But also this, when we are celebrating, when we are just having a great time, we need Jesus there as well. Because that's where all that came from in the first place. I still cannot imagine this plan of God, that sent his only begotten Son into the world. God, knowing that we couldn't do it on our own, so he sends Jesus, his only Son. Can you imagine? Christ came into this world with this little baby. I'm sure Mary and Joseph looked down at this little small child and realized that they were looking at the face of God. But he began to grow, just like kids do. He began to grow. And then it became time that Jesus was to step out and answer the call that was on his life. This week is the real beginning of that call as he prepares to love us by going to the cross. But not only that, this time next week, there'll be such a great celebration because the tomb is empty. And that's when he says, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come and receive you unto myself. I love Holy Week. I love Holy Week. Because there's so many ups and downs and twists and turns and all these things in Holy Week. I love it. And I love reading the scriptures of Holy Week. Because, once again, the only reason Jesus Christ came into this world was for me. You can go ahead and think that for yourself if you want to, but I know for a fact that the only reason Christ came was for me, because I couldn't have got there without him. And I can't get there without him now. This week has always meant so much to me, because I take claim of this week. Because I truly believe that Jesus Christ came just for me. He gave his life for me. But the other thing is too, when that tomb was empty, it tells me that one day my grave is going to be empty as well. So this week begins. Spend a little more time with Jesus. You can read if you'd like to, but spend a little time quietly and listen for that small, still voice of God. Because this is a week that'll go like this every day. Even when we know the outcome. Even when we realize of the love of Christ for the whole world. If you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, I invite you to come and do so. If you're once on fire for Christ and kind of drifted away, you can come back and Jesus will never say where you've been or what you've been doing. He just opens his arms again and says, welcome back. Or maybe in your world there is something, a burden that you're carrying. Scripture says if we'll cast our burdens on him, that he will carry those for us. As we sing this final hymn, which is 277. See, I knew it would come to me. 277. Yeah, okay. Please stand. This altar is open this day.
Thank you.
Remember this, salvation comes on God's terms. And that means giving God our very lives, our very nature, and our very own selfish desires. It means, once again, handing ourselves completely over to God and trusting God to take control of our lives, to change us, to guide us, to direct us, to use us, so that we can love God and others and be freed from the chains of selfish desires. In this journey through this week, remember that this journey for Jesus Christ came just because of you, just because of me, just because of each one of us individually. The walk, the journey that he will take is a nasty, nasty, difficult, unbelievable journey. But Sunday's a-coming, and that tomb is still empty this day. And the church comes together and says, amen, 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 and amen. Amen. Have a great week in Jesus Christ.
Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Yeshua,
Yeshua, you reign on high, you reign on high. Almighty God, your love is like no other. Yeshua, you reign on high, you reign on high. Almighty God, your love is like no other. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Yeshua,
Yeshua, you reign on high, you reign on high. Almighty God, your love is like no other. Yeshua, you reign on high, you reign on high. Almighty God, your love is like no other. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Come on now.
Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Prepare ye the way, prepare ye the way of the Lord.